The biggest problem with studying stars is their distance. They're just so far away, we haven't got a chance of going close up to have a look at one. The only way we can find out about the stars is by gathering the light that arrives from them. And to do that, we use telescopes.
Light is crucial to our understanding of the cosmos. At first glance, all the stars may appear the same, but take a closer look at the constellation Orion.
The top left star in Orion is called Betelgeuse. The bottom right star in Orion is called Rigel. If you look carefully at those stars, you'll see that Betelgeuse is really quite red, whereas Rigel is really quite blue. Now actually, that difference is because they're different temperatures. So the colour of a star can actually tell us its temperature.
Somewhat counterintuitively, red stars are comparatively cool, while blue stars are hotter.
Just looking at the visible light from the stars gives us a huge amount of information, but it's not all that there is, and in fact there's more that we can find out.
Visible light is just one part of the electromagnetic spectrum, but there is a huge amount of light out beyond the red and the blue that we just can't see, such as X-rays, infrared, and radio waves. And with telescopes, we can open the window on this invisible universe. Telescopes like Jodrell Bank's giant 76-meter Lovell radio telescope and ESA's Herschel Space Telescope, which can see the sky in infrared.
When we look at things in infrared light, we can get extra information on top of what we can see when using visible light. So let's take these two cups of tea, for example. In visible light, they look virtually identical. Be hard-pressed to tell them apart. When we look at them in infrared light, such as with this special camera, we can see that they look very different. So the one on the left appears red, and the one on the right appears blue. And that tells us that the one on the left is warmer than the one on the right, which is quite useful if you actually want to go and drink a cup of tea.
Using infrared and radio telescopes also has other advantages.
If we had eyes that were sensitive to radio waves, if we had little radio dishes for eyes, and we looked up now, we'd actually be able to see through the clouds. We can do radio astronomy during the day as well as at night. We would be able to see right through the clouds now, straight out into space.
Telescopes like Herschel can also allow us to overcome one of the biggest problems astronomers face. Dust.
Dust is the bane of an astronomer's life. It's not the same as dust in a house. Dust in a house is basically a lot of its dead skin and so on. But dust in astronomy is tiny grains of carbon and silicon. So it's a little bit like sand in that kind of sense. If you look up at the night sky on a clear night, you may well see the Milky Way stretching across the skies. But all along its length, you'll see there are dark lanes, and these are dust lanes, and it's dust that's blocking our view of the stars that lie behind. What we know is that behind those dust lanes, there's a lot of interesting stuff going on. That dust, in a few tens or hundreds of millions of years, some of it will become new stars. Those stars that are currently in the process of forming are currently shrouded by this dust, and we simply can't see through using visible light.
Imagine I'm looking out into deep space, and I'm looking at a dust cloud that's black in visible light. I can't tell anything about it. It's obscuring anything that might be going on behind. Well, to see what's going on behind, we need to look at infrared wavelengths. We can use our infrared camera, and I can point at the cloth, and we can see that in the centre there's a bright yellow splodge, and that tells us that in the centre it's a lot warmer than it is around the edge, and this is very analogous to what Herschel does with dust in space. The dust might be much cooler, but the dust is being heated up by, for example, stars behind. So from this I can infer that there's something behind the cloth, or the dust, that's heating it up. So it's got to be something hot, and it's probably got to be something bright as well.
Using infrared light, Herschel will reveal some of the secrets about how stars form inside these giant clouds of dust and gas.
Each of these views of the universe gives us a different piece of a jigsaw, and when we put those pieces together, we get a complete picture of the object that we're studying.
the electromagnetic spectrum, an immense scale we use to measure the wavelengths of all kinds of radiation. At one end are radio waves with the longest wavelengths. At the other end are gamma rays with the shortest. In between are the other bands, including visible light, which is such a tiny fraction of the whole, it's difficult to imagine. How small is the visible spectrum? If you had a reel of movie film representing the entire electromagnetic spectrum, stretching 2,500 miles from California to Alaska, the section containing the visible spectrum would fall somewhere in the middle, near the University of Washington.
This frame is the whole visible spectrum. It is one frame in over 2,000 miles of tape, and it's everything that the human eye can see. The importance of this frame is that stars emit almost all of their light in this part of the spectrum.
And even though the light is visible, it still contains hidden tools. The secrets are in the spectrum itself. The visible light in this lamp comes from hydrogen gas excited by electricity to form a glowing plasma, similar to what happens in a nebula. By viewing the lamp through a diffraction grating, we can split the light up into three narrow lines on the spectrum, a virtual fingerprint of light, unique to hydrogen alone.
So in the spectrum, you see three features. One is red, one is a light blue, and the other is a deep blue. This pattern of wavelengths is absolutely unique to hydrogen, and there's no way to confuse hydrogen in the spectrum with any other element.
We know a few things. We know that light is electromagnetic radiation created by moving electrons. With help from Jupiter's moon Io, we know that light travels across empty space at 186,000 miles per second. And as we have seen, stars vary in apparent brightness, and knowing the star's distance, we can use the inverse square law to find its intrinsic luminosity. The other thing we know is that stars have different colors. And very interestingly, color tells us a lot more than you might think. But to understand color, we need to know more about light. Light, as we currently understand it, as a dual nature. We can view it as a particle, like a photon, or we can view it as a wave that can interfere with itself. Although we haven't been able to reconcile these two incompatible views with one underlying understanding, what we do know has turned out to be surprisingly sufficient for the distance ladder. For color, we view light as a wave. Here's a simple wave. It has a repeating cycle, a wavelength, and a frequency in cycles per second. Newton showed that the sun's light can be dispersed into the colors of the rainbow with a crystal. This effect comes from the wave nature of light. Different colors represent different light frequencies. The higher the frequency, or inversely, the shorter the wavelength, the more it's bent by the crystal. This produces a spectrum of light with blue and violet at the high frequency end and red at the low frequency end. An important relationship between energy and light is that a light's energy is directly proportional to the frequency. So when physicists see color, they think energy. Red is low energy light, and blue is high energy light. Here we see the full electromagnetic spectrum with visible light in the middle. Radiation with longer wavelengths and smaller frequencies than red light is called infrared, and still longer wavelengths are called radio waves. Moving up the energy scale, radiation with shorter wavelengths than violet light is called ultraviolet, Still shorter wavelengths are called X-rays, and the maximum energy radiation is called gamma rays. Celestial objects shine in radio to infrared, visible light, and ultraviolet to X-rays. One of the very important relationships between light and matter is called blackbody radiation. Turns out that the color of most matter at high temperatures depends completely and totally on the temperature. Nothing else really matters. Take a look at this iron rod as it heats up. See how it goes from red hot at the outer edges, through yellow, to white hot at the center? If we could get it hot enough, you'd see it turning blue. Here's why. As temperature increases and the electrons start moving more rapidly, two things happen. One, the object emits more radiation at all wavelengths. And two, the peak emission frequency shifts towards the shorter, higher energy blue wavelengths. As the heating starts, the radiation is all in the infrared range, so we can't see it. As the temperature approaches 2000 degrees Celsius, we begin to see red. We've seen the red star Aldebaran. It's a good example of this. By 3000 degrees, the red has morphed to orange. Arcturus is an example of this. By 4000 degrees, it is quite yellow. Capella and our own sun are yellow. Around 6000 degrees, it is turning white. The star Sirius A is an example of this. And by 10,000 degrees, it has a distinct bluish color. Spica is a good example of a blue star. So the bottom line is, measure the color of a star via the frequency of the light it emits, and you've determined its temperature. It's that simple. Now that we know star temperatures via their color, and luminosity via their parallax distance, we can build a diagram I mentioned in the introduction. In 1913, Ingnar Hertzsprung and Henry Russell began mapping these star temperatures against their luminosity. Note that the horizontal axis is mapping temperatures in the decreasing direction. If we begin with the stars we use to illustrate blackbody radiation, Aldebaran, Arcturus, Capella, our own sun, Sirius A, and Spica, and throw in a few others like Sirius B, Wolf 359, Polaris, and Vega, we get a graph that looks like this. With this small sample, it looks like any combination of temperature and luminosity is possible. But Hertzsprung and Russell meticulously plotted all the stars with known distance and luminosities. And they got this. Here we see that most stars fall on the diagonal line from the upper left, hot, blue, luminous stars, down to the lower right, cooler, dimmer, red stars. But there is also a grouping of stars well below the main line, and two groupings of stars well above the main line. This is the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, or HR diagram for short. It is one of the most important tools in understanding stars ever devised. It tells us a great deal about the life, death, and age of stars. And, more importantly, for our purposes, it can tell us how far away stars are. But in order for the HR diagram to do this, we need to know more about what makes stars shine, and we need to know more about the full spectrum of light we receive from these stars. In our segment on star birth nebula, we'll cover how stars form from giant hydrogen clouds collapsing under the force of gravity. They start shining once the pressure and temperature at the core reaches the level needed to support hydrogen fusion. The fusion of hydrogen into helium converts some of the mass into energy. And because E equals mc squared, and c is a very big number, the process generates a great deal of energy. The more hydrogen there is in the collapsing cloud, the more massive the star. The more massive the star, the more intense the pressure in its core. The more intense the pressure, the higher the temperature. The higher the temperature, the greater the star's luminosity. Thus, the diagonal line on the HR diagram represents the main sequence for stars burning hydrogen. The upper left blue and white hot stars are high mass stars, many times more massive than the Sun. The middle region, yellow and orange stars, are closer to the mass of the Sun. The lower right stars are cool, low mass stars that are a fraction of the mass of the Sun. When a star runs out of hydrogen fuel, the core contracts and gets hotter. This heat expands the outer layers, reducing the density and turning the star red. The star moves off the main sequence and enters the realm of giants or supergiants, depending on their original mass. When a red giant, with a mass less than 5 times the mass of the Sun, runs out of fuel, it explodes and leaves behind a dim, hot, tiny star called a white dwarf. We'll discuss these processes more in our segment on planetary nebula. We'll cover the endgame for more massive stars in our segment on supernova. Now that we understand the meaning of the HR diagram, let's see how we can use it to find out how far away a star is. For that, we need to view light as a particle and examine its spectrum. Early in the 19th century, German chemist Joseph Fraunhofer invented the spectroscope, an instrument to automatically separate light and mark the wavelengths. In so doing, he discovered that when he spread sunlight into a spectrum, the spectrum was crossed by a great number of fine, dark lines. He had no idea what these dark lines were, but today we know that they were the key to learning what stars are made of. Remember the red and green light of the aurora borealis and the structure of molecules we discussed in our segment on the heliosphere? The aurora is a good example of light being emitted as electrons change energy levels. But for our purposes here, we want to examine what happens when light from the center of a star passes through the gases in the outer layers on its way to us. Here's how it works. When a photon with exactly the right energy level hits an electron orbiting a nucleus, its entire energy is transformed to the electron, which jumps to a higher energy level with a larger quantum number. The photon is eliminated. This creates absorption lines in a star's spectrum as light from the star travels through the star's atmosphere. Every atom and molecule has its own spectral line signature. So by observing the absorption lines in a star's spectrum, we can tell what elements are present. When scientists discovered connections between groups of spectral lines and star temperatures, they developed a set of spectral classifications to highlight star content. Star spectra has one more characteristic called luminosity class that enable us to determine whether a star is on the main sequence or not. This is the key to using the HR diagram to determine a star's distance. If you recall, the evolution of a star off the main sequence involves the expansion of the outer layer to gargantuan proportions. This makes the density of the gas in the outer layer of a giant much less than the density in the outer layer of a star on the main sequence. It turns out that the photon absorption characteristics of closely packed atoms makes the spectral lines fuzzier. So for a given spectral class, the fuzzier the spectral line, the smaller the star. We'll use Betelgeuse to illustrate how this works. First, we use the star's color, temperature, and spectra to find its point on the horizontal axis. Looking up the vertical luminosity axis, we see Betelgeuse could either be a main sequence star or a supergiant. Examining the luminosity class, we see that it is very sharp, implying that Betelgeuse is a supergiant. Now, drawing the line to the vertical axis, we see that the star's intrinsic luminosity is 120,000 times greater than our sun's luminosity. Measuring the apparent luminosity and using the inverse square law, we get the distance. Betelgeuse is 643 light years, or 3,730 trillion miles away. If stars everywhere behave like the stars in our neighborhood, then the HR diagram can show us how far away they are. Astronomers call this technique spectroscopic parallax, but we'll just stick with HR diagram. Now let's return to stargazing. We'll start with our old friend, Betelgeuse. Betelgeuse is a very rich, reddish, cool, supergiant carbon star. It is also one of the largest and most luminous stars known. If it were at the center of the solar system, its surface would extend past the orbit of Jupiter. CHCYG is a symbiotic star system in which a white dwarf feeds from the solar wind of a companion red giant star. Rigel is the sixth brightest star in the sky. Since 1943, the spectrum of this star has served as one of the stable anchor points by which other stars are classified. Like Polaris, Delta Cephei is a binary star system and a Cepheid variable star. Cepheid stars undergo periodic changes in luminosity. Delta Cephei is among the closest stars of this type of variable, with only Polaris being closer. Most stars have some variability in their luminosity. Even our Sun varies on an 11-year cycle of sunspots. But Delta Cephei's variability is caused by regular pulsation in the outer layer of the star. Here's its light curve, showing luminosity changes over time. The pattern is quite regular. Early in the 1900s, an American astronomer, Henrietta Leavitt, thought to plot Cepheid luminosity cycle periods against luminosity. She found that the period of these stars varied in proportion to their absolute brightness. This was very interesting, because as we have discussed, once we know the intrinsic luminosity of a star, we can easily calculate its distance. Leavitt's discovery made Cepheid stars true standard candles and changed the history of astronomy. Zeta Geminorum is an intermediate luminous supergiant. It is also a classical Cepheid variable. RR Lyra is a variable star, like Delta Cephei. As the brightest star in its class, it became the namesake for the RR Lyra variable class of stars. The relationship between pulsation period and absolute magnitude of the RR Lyras make them good standard candles. They are not as bright as Cepheid variables, but there are a lot more of them. They are extensively used in globular cluster studies, including the studies that helped us understand the form and size of our Milky Way galaxy. HIP 13044 came from outside our galaxy. It was part of a former dwarf galaxy that merged with the Milky Way between 6 and 9 billion years ago. Kilira is a carbon star. It has used up most of its hydrogen fuel and is now fusing helium into carbon. This star is very faint. It is made of almost purely hydrogen and helium, with only extremely small amounts of heavier elements. We estimate that the star is probably more than 13 billion years old. That would make it one of the oldest stars in the universe. Mu Cephei is a red supergiant star. In fact, it is one of the largest and most luminous stars known in the Milky Way. This star could fit a billion suns into its volume. Eta Carinae, 10,000 light-years away, is estimated to be 100 times more massive than our Sun. It is one of the most massive stars in the galaxy. It radiates about 5 million times more power than our Sun, and its mass, as you can see, also makes it very unstable. Hubble's latest image of the star V838 Monocerotis reveals dramatic changes in the illumination of surrounding dusty cloud structures. The effect, called a light echo, has been unveiling never-before-seen dust patterns ever since the star suddenly brightened for several weeks in early 2002. During the outburst, the normal faint star suddenly brightened, becoming 600,000 times more luminous than our Sun. Here's another carbon star, like Betelgeuse, only AWCYG is much further away. Hypervelocity stars are stars that are moving so fast that they can literally escape the galaxy's gravitational pull and move into intergalactic space. The first example of a hypervelocity star was discovered in 1995. HVS2 is the second such star to be discovered. It's moving at 440 miles per second. It is believed that these stars were once members of a binary star system which passed in the vicinity of the Milky Way's supermassive black hole. The black hole's tremendous gravitational pull stripped one member while violently ejecting the other member into deep space at very high velocities. This is another hypervelocity star. It is moving with a velocity of 500 miles per second and is expected to leave the Milky Way in 80 to 100 million years. The star is destined to roam the empty depths of intergalactic space. We have taken a look at a few of the hundreds of billions of stars in our Milky Way galaxy. For our neighborhood, we extended the parallax technique used for the solar system to work for the stars. And thanks to Hipparchus, we know the distance to hundreds of thousands of stars, which are relatively close to the Sun. Having reached as far as parallax can take us, we introduce the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram for estimating star luminosity. We also introduce standard candles with Cepheid and RR Lyra variable stars that identify their own luminosity with the period of their variable luminosity cycles. These rungs in our distance ladder have taken us across the entire Milky Way. In subsequent sections, we'll use these distance ladder techniques on star birth nebula, star death nebula, and the structure of the galaxy itself.